Jeff Roorda, business manager of the St. Louis Police Officers Association. Gentlemen, thank you for being with us today. Jeff Roorda, make the case for this move by President Trump. We obviously spent a lot of time together in Ferguson. We saw the plus and the minus of the presence there of police and how they were acquitting themselves. What do you make of this move?
Well, Chris, as you know, I'm down here in Nashville for the Fraternal Order of Police National Convention. General Sessions was here yesterday announcing the lift on the ban, and it was very well received. University law enforcement officers were thrilled to hear that this protective defensive equipment is going to be available to us again, and that's exactly what it is. It saved cops' lives in Ferguson and in other places where we've had mob violence, and we ought to put it in the hands of cops so they can be safe.
Cedric Alexander, is it as simple as that to you?
No, not quite as simple. Certainly I do understand what Mr. Roorda is saying. And being a police veteran myself, one thing we want to do, we want to keep our police officers safe, Chris, and that is critically important. But I think the difference is here, and I too were there on the ground with you guys in Ferguson during those early days. One of the issues that occurred there in Ferguson is that the optic of militarized weapons being used against American citizens who were exercising their First Amendment right became the issue. Now, certainly there was times when there was gunfire, there was violence, and certainly you want to do and make sure you have the proper equipment to take care of your personnel. If the president is going to go in that direction, and it appeared that he is, then here's what I would say as a law enforcement official and as a city leader, is that if this equipment is going to be issued to police departments across the country, several things has to happen. I think, first of all, cities need to meet some certain criteria to receive that equipment. Number two, there needs to be extreme training on that equipment. There needs to be policies that are written that will determine when and where that equipment is used. And I think it becomes critically important that the community, the police, and their legal sections all sit down and have a discussion as to how to best introduce whatever equipment they choose to desire into their communities. We live in a very dangerous time, Chris, and if we go back to San Bernardino, our police officers are going to need equipment to protect them in order to make the rescues, in order to engage a real threat that we know are out there, both domestic and foreign. But it has to be training, policy, and community involvement to make sure that everyone is on the same page and understanding the importance of keeping everyone safe. But at the same time, Chris, I think it becomes critically important that people understand, considering the history, that we have a better optic than what we had before.
All right, so this gets a little complicated, right? It becomes about the realities on the ground for police versus the optics and the perception mm-hmm. of those they are policing. I mean, all three of us are very well aware of cases where officers have been outgunned, where they're going against people who have weapons that are military grade. All right, so that's one scenario. So, Jeff, Cedric outlined a different one, which is that, and we heard it from Senator Rand Paul, Republican from Kentucky, saying, that this sends a bad message, that this is a police state, not just police, and that that's not a message that you want to send to the American people. What do you say to people who are afraid that they don't want military-style weapons and equipment being used against them?
To Cedric's point and to Senator Paul's point, law enforcement has evolved and evolved very quickly post-Ferguson, and I think they are more aware that it's not just tactics, that it's also optics, and that they've got to balance their response. But remember, we call this military equipment, but a lot of it came into the use of the military after law enforcement had already been using it for years when our military in Iraq started getting into situations in urban warfare. And again, just like law enforcement, the military was using that equipment defensively, not offensively, and we have to be careful about blanketly calling this equipment military equipment when it is, in its very essence, protective equipment that, again, you saw the Bearcats in Ferguson. Mm-hmm. Every one of those armored vehicles was scarred with bullet marks, and each one of those scars represents a cop that could have been killed.
Hmm. Cedric, what do you say to people who are concerned that this sends a bad message?
Well, it sends a bad message merely because of what the perception and optics have been in the past. And certainly community have a reason to be concerned with that. We have seen more militarization of police departments across this country in recent years. Community has continuously telling us that's not what they want to see. But there are going to be, this is not the type of equipment that would be introduced into a community every day. Right. This equipment, if the president is going to use this or say police departments can use it again, there has to be policy as to when and where and how it will be introduced. But right. we need to be very, very careful when it comes to using this equipment against American citizens who are exercising their First Amendment right. right. And quite frankly, many departments, and I think Roorda would agree, many departments have become very sensitized to this issue. And many departments now take that equipment in situations where they feel something is going to become very dangerous. They do keep it out of sight. But it cannot just become a mainframe, a part of what we're doing policing every day. That's not going to be accepted by the community. It's not going to be accepted by elected officials, because at the end of the day, me being a deputy mayor in my city, mm-hmm. I'm going to determine as to when and where and how and if this equipment will be utilized. That's who it really rests on, is the city leaders, elected officials, and community members.
And the balance of message. Do you put equal money and resources into community policing and body cameras as you do into the military-style equipment? You know, then you wind up sending a different message to the populace than just doing one of those moves. Jeff, Cedric, thank you very much, gentlemen. Appreciate your perspective on this.
Thank you for having me.
You made us better for it.
You bet.
All right, we're following a lot of news. Let's get after it.